conspiracy.com. He's also written another book on Bigfoot, and you can link up to that at Grand Ark Conspiracy as well. Welcome to the Grand Ark Conspiracy, Matthew. It's a pleasure to have you on the program.
Well, thank you very much.
So how was it that you became interested in Bigfoot?
Well, I've really been interested in Bigfoot for over 20 years. Probably in high school and been kind of doing with it ever since.
So it's just something that grabbed your imagination and you went with it. You've never seen a Bigfoot or anything like that, have you?
No, I never actually had. Now, I live in an area where that might show up, but I've never had myself.
So, for you, it's something that you think is plausible, then?
Oh, yes. Well, I am a scientist. And clearly from the whole, there's DNA evidence, there's the mole bridge evidence, which is what you would call fingerprints or footprints or whatever. There's quite a bit of evidence. Genetic evidence is a big one for me. I've got a degree that there's a lot of genetic stuff in it, so I understand that stuff very well.
So, you know, when people say that there's no possibility that there's a Bigfoot, it's not really taking into account all the variables then?
They don't take the little things into account. They assume that because we don't have a body, that we don't have any evidence. Well, that's just not true. We have, there's witness counts, witnesses are not always the most credible things in the world, but they exist. There are castings. There are, actually, there's the more bridge casting. The more bridge is the footprints, the extoe prints. There's that. There's the fingerprints, the handprints that have been caught in glass. There's the hairs. They do not have a medulla, which is the kind of the core, I guess, of a hair, human hair. The scaling on it is very, very similar to human, which is right in between that between the human and the gorilla, but they're not close. You can definitely tell that. There's, you know, there's blood evidence, which really that was really good on the $1 million with challenge or something like $1 million. They would use mosquitoes to basically collect blood evidence. I thought that was a great idea.
So
there's, I'm sorry.
No, so we're looking at something that there actually is a lot of evidence for, but for whatever reason, no one is willing to kind of accept what's been put forward. Do you think that there's a reason for that? I mean, do you think that people just are resistant to the idea of a bipedal primate of sorts being in the wilderness in the United States?
Part of it is people are in a state of a superiority complex, and that we are the first, we are the best, we did everything ourselves. They don't like the idea or ignore the idea that someone else did that first. I can't do North America first, or did anything first, or they really don't like that they might be wrong. Most of what they'll think is actually that they don't know. They, like my editor, I was explaining a lot of things to her. She was like, well, there's only one Bigfoot out there, isn't there? Like, are you kidding? you can't have just one. I mean, she's only comfortable with him. Are you kidding me? But people think all kinds of things like that, that no wonder they don't believe. They have no clue. They don't care. What? I mean, their life is going to work, making money, come home, and feed the family. That life is not Bigfoot. That's just the way it is. Most people aren't concerned. They're concerned with what's going off in day to day.
Well, that is true. Most people don't have, I guess, the time to concern themselves with the existence of, this creature out in the woods. But it is interesting that, a lot of people do kind of think that there would be only one Bigfoot, not assuming that if it's a real animal, there would need to be a much larger population in order for, really, if there was one Bigfoot and it was as good as hiding from everybody as it seems to be, we would never, ever see that, and we wouldn't even have stories about Bigfoot.
No. There's only what she was saying, but there's only one Bigfoot, right? First of all, and I've heard this many, many times, there are a bunch of big feet running out somewhere. No. It's called Bigfoots. There's one two-legged animal would be a big feet, right? how many bones are loose all the way to Bigfoot beef? Like, are you kidding me? Good grief. They have all kinds of things.
So when you're looking at this, when you wrote the book, How to Spot a Bigfoot Hoax, was the hope for this book then to show people, the possibilities of whether or not they're having a real sighting or not, to kind of educate them on that? Because, in the beginning of the book, you kind of lay out, the different ways that we could be deceived about the reported Bigfoot sightings.
So easily. If you ever go to a magician, you think you are all over the place. He is an expert. Now, most people, most hoaxers, are not experts. Even if there's an expert doing it, there's always at least one thing that is not true, and it ought to be your job to find it. There's lots of different methods for deceiving. That's been done for thousands of years. And if you've ever watched the film games, you know that, that happens all the time. That happens far more easily than you might think it does. It's not that your brain is failing you. It's that this is a loophole, and that's how it works.
So they just kind of slip it in between the in the space in between then.
Oh yeah, like if you go in the woods, you see something large with hair all over it walking past. Your first thought is Bigfoot. Your first thought is not down amongst you walking around the woods.
So,
he was a tall guy, or tall, whatever. Most people do not. I am just incredible. People do not realize the people use stilts. Look at the Comic-Con photographs. There's people with stilts all over the place. Look at Uncle Sam. Every 4th of July, there's a 3-foot tall Uncle Sam walking around. You think that's natural? People put our stilts on walk around amongst you all the time. Height is nothing to do with reality. That just means they can do it that way. They can do it very easily. That's one of the easiest things to hoax, is the height. So you see a 10-foot Indian thing walking around, like, oh my goodness, that thing can't be human.
So
aliens.
the first thing that we can't really kind of assume is just because something then is tall is that it is in fact a Bigfoot.
There's that, like I said, that's one of the easiest things to hoax. And, well, that is not something to, because people do walk around in the woods in these outfits with with skirts on. They do that. People do all kinds of things that are not logical. Just because it's not logical doesn't mean they won't do it. They do all kinds of things like that.
So, I mean, one of the things that you've put in the book is the rules that a Bigfoot lives by. How did you kind of disseminate this information? How was it through doing research from all the sightings that you felt was genuine? I mean, or looking at, I mean, how did you come up with these rules?
Apparently, it's one rule pretty much, but there's several variations. And that comes from seeing what has happened and seeing what has not happened. Like if Matt Moneymaker went out and did a bunch of smoke and rolled a bunch of stakes and all of a sudden, there were no Bigfoots. There's a reason why. It's that he's not finding Bigfoot. There's not that he's looking for Bigfoot. So, something that fire is a purely human thing. It can happen naturally, but humans are the only animals in the world. They can make it themselves. And Bigfoots avoid that in particular. Why would that be?
And that's something that's a very interesting question because, most animals will avoid fire out of fear, but a lot of reports from stories about Bigfoot, he'll walk into a campsite, where there's a fire going, while people are sleeping. So it's clear that he's not afraid of fire.
That's exactly correct. That's exactly correct. So it's not the fire, it's the cooking. He's probably the fire, but intentionally does not create fire himself. Intentionally does not cook food himself. One or other, those two.
So why would that be true? I mean, is Bigfoot
He has a secret history with humans that is not our civilization, previous human civilization. One thing that I have said is that why did the Romans not breed tall people with tall people? Why did they not do that? Because they're all about war and battle and all that stuff. If you have a very large warrior, just go to combat of people. You do all kinds of damage. Why didn't they do that? When Rome fell hard. You had the 600 years of dark ages. So we could walk into the emperor's bedroom and see what files he was looking at. I mean, we know for sure they did not do anything like it. Besides, Bigfoot would be in Europe and Bigfoot wouldn't be in North America. So it had to be a previous civilization that basically started in America. So
So,
it had.
as I say, so then logically we're looking at a species of creature that has a history with humans, to some degree, that has been lost on our side, but retained on the memory has been retained on theirs.
Yep, it has history with humans, and in general, it's certain things that all humans are the same. So a primitive civilization, but with the exact same as our civilization, compared upon you.
So it's a learned trait that the Bigfoot then avoid us, and they don't want to be around us, and they even go as far to avoid behaviors that would make them similar to us.
Yep. So, the Bigfoot, they're kind of like a kid that is met up the park. So they try and do everything they can do not to be like them. Same thing. Some of these civilizations are a big split that happened. And so there were several of them. They split off from each other. And they would have to, you know, to battle each other, you have to go through a mid-world period, they battle each other, and create these quote-unquote ultimate weapons, and make big people. One person starts it, then another person, then another person, then another person, then this whole bunch of them. And they're all slightly different. They're all over the place. And you get past that. You, well, this and I'll move up, and then, well, this will be all the weapon, but we still got these, we're still kids. What do we do with them? Okay, we can let them into the woods. Some civilizations keep going, some civilizations don't. And they're not at the prince. It's not.
So, when we're looking at that, I mean, but it still falls back to that is the reason why then we have trouble finding the Bigfoot, is because unlike a lot of other animals, they have the capacity to avoid us. And they also have the will to avoid us. They don't want to have any interaction with human beings. They want... Pretty much, it almost sounds as if they would rather human beings didn't exist themselves.
Yeah. So, like an adolescent child.
So.
They are a breed of humans that have been bred to be tall. There were some they've been bred, well, they've been bred to be tall, to be warriors. So we're stealthy, we're just big, we're strong. That sounds like Bigfoot name. And all these characteristics are still alive. That is the same characteristics you would that be useful in the woods. You can bury your dead just like a human. And would you find the bones? Do you find dead humans in the middle of the city?
Right.
So why would you expect to find a dead human in the middle of the city if we bury our dead? Why would you find one at all? Why would you find a Bigfoot? Why would you find a human? Just living out in the woods. We know humans have been in the woods. So why aren't there dead humans all over the woods? Why aren't there dead humans all over human cities? Yep. They're a symbolizer. They bury them.
So, I mean, that's a great explanation for why it is we don't find the remains. I mean, and we're talking about Bigfoots as a variation of humans, bred for a very specific reason. Almost like part of a eugenics program, then
we
begin to have a very simple explanation for why it is we don't find the remains. They buried their dead, much like we do.
Exactly. It's not a huge, complicated explanation. So it's a simple one. That's the way most things are. They're very simple. Now, finding that is not the easiest thing in the world, but once you do, simple answer.
Now, I mean, in this instance, if we're looking at the fact that the Bigfoot bury their dead, I mean, are they tool users then, or do they do this by hand?
Mostly, they do not use tools because that is a human trait to use tools. They do not use fire to keep warm. They live in very, very cold climates often. Why don't they use fire? Why don't they use blankets? Why don't they use buckets to protect water? Why don't they do any of those things? Because it's too human. They're basically met at the parents.
So they also, I mean, there's a lot that we can go into here on this one point. I mean, why is it that then they would bury their dead? Because that's a very human thing. Are there other animals in nature that do that as well?
I'm not sure there is, actually. I think some rodents may eat them on the ground, but that's about all I know of. But something like that requires at least sentient knowledge or sentient level of brain development. There are actually, I think, past and present, there are almost 20 animals on Earth to become sentient. Sentient means self-aware, they're conscious, things like that.
Right. So they would be one of a handful, basically. I mean, when you look at all the species on here that are sentient and aware, self-aware.
Right.
And, I mean, I know there's not a lot of animals that can claim that.
No.
Well, none of them can actually vocalize it, but there's not a lot of animals out there we're aware of that are, in fact, sentient. But, it's suggestive to me, I mean, when you look at how the Bigfoot act and are, reported to be, they definitely do seem to have a high level of sentience and are very self-aware and even probably more aware of their environment than when we are when we're in it. And I don't know if that's just simply because they are used to their environment and they know how to interact in the environment and we're the foreign invader in that situation.
Yeah, they were born and raised in the woods. They lived their entire lives in multiple generations in the woods. They're way, way more aware of the woods than we are. You know, maybe 500 years ago, we were similar, but we haven't been a long, long time. But they have.
We're talking with Matthew B. Thompson, and you can link up to his book at grandarkconspiracy.com and get yourself a copy of How to Spot a Bigfoot Hoax, and also How Not to Find a Bigfoot. Those are the two books that we'll be talking about tonight with Matthew. I would encourage you to do that. And when we come back, we'll continue the conversation with Matthew on the other.
This is Pete Emmons of Ag Today, inviting you to join us every Monday morning at 9 a.m. on QT 1270 and streaming online at qt1270.com.
We live in a pretty nice neighborhood, really safe. Yeah, a few families have security systems, but not us. We felt really safe. Till last week, when someone broke into our home. We were gone less than an hour, and they took just about everything that wasn't nailed down. Jewelry, TVs, artwork, even the kids' video games. We thought this couldn't ever happen to us. We thought wrong. My wife and I felt violated, and our kids were scared to go back in the house. So we asked one of the neighbors about their security system, from Alliance, and then we called them.
If you think this can't happen to you, think again. Then call Alliance Security and get peace of mind for less, a lot less. We offer free same-day installation for many neighborhoods, plus give you a $100 Visa gift card. Call us right now at 1-800-593-9601. That's 1-800-593-9601. Free same-day installation and a $100 Visa gift card. 1-800-593-9601.
Policies issued by American General Life Insurance Company, Houston, Texas. Not available in all states. For details, visit AIGdirect.com.
So I knew it was important to have life insurance to protect our family, but I was putting it off. But then yesterday, a girlfriend of mine asked me, point blank, what would happen if you lost your husband? How would you pay the bills? The mortgage? The car payments? Food? And that's when it really hit me, and I realized I needed to get us life insurance. Right now. So I called AIG Direct, and in less than 5 minutes, I had a quote. I was shocked at how affordable it is. Now just $14 a month for $250,000 of term life coverage. I feel so much better knowing the kids and I are protected. And my husband was so happy I got the quote.
Save up to 70% when you get term life insurance through AIG Direct. Call now for a free, no obligation quote. It only takes 5 minutes and you could save up to 70%. Call now 1-800-566-2821. That's 1-800-566-2821. 1-800-566-2821.
This is a referral service. Calls will be routed to an independent referral insurance agency.
Do you know the number one cause of bankruptcy? No, it's not losing your job or running up credit card debt. It's not even divorce. It's medical costs. If you and your family don't have health insurance, just one serious illness or accident could be financially devastating. But now there's good news, really good news. A health insurance hotline has been established to provide health insurance for all Americans, even uninsured Americans with pre-existing conditions. Now anyone can get health insurance even if you have a pre-existing medical condition. I repeat, now anyone can get health insurance coverage. Call now for a free no-obligation quote on affordable health plans available to you. Again, this is a free hotline for anyone, even if you have pre-existing conditions. Protect you and your family from sudden unexpected medical costs. Call the free health insurance hotline right now at 1-800-842-1835. That's 1-800-842-1835. Call 1-800-842-1835.
8. I deliver your Sunday paper every week.
7. We work on the same floor.
1 in 8 Americans is struggling with hunger.
6. Our kids walk to school together every day,
including millions of children and seniors.
5. We chat in the elevator at work sometimes.
4. I'm your cashier at the grocery store.
Who's the 1 in 8 in your life that needs help? You can make a difference through Feeding America at feedingamerica.org/1in8. A public service announcement brought to you by Feeding America and the Ad Council.
From True Oldies 1270 WQTT, here is your Marysville area weatherbug forecast. For the rest of the morning, there's a slight chance of snow. Here today, mostly cloudy, low 24, weather winds to 15 miles an hour. Wednesday, snow is likely. Here today, mostly cloudy, weather high 35. Accumulations around 1 inch are possible. Look for snow Wednesday night, low 8. We could have 1 inch or 2. Wind chills will be around 5 below with winds to 15 miles an hour. Thursday, we'll have a mostly sunny, cold day, our high 15 with wind chills to 10 below. For True Oldies 1270, I'm Rod Tanner.
B. Thompson tonight, and we're talking about how to spot a Bigfoot hoax and how not to find Bigfoot. Those are the books that you can link up to at grandarkconspiracy.com to to get those for yourself to find out a little bit more about what we're talking about. So, Matthew, one of the things that I find very interesting in the book is, you know, the Bigfoot, they don't, well, you lay out what their diet is, and I think a lot of listeners would be interested into, you know, understanding what exactly a Bigfoot's going to eat, because that's something that I see on the Bigfoot shows, and I read about all these people introducing foods into their environment, hoping that they're going to get a Bigfoot to eat it, and it doesn't seem to be, well, it doesn't seem to be effective like most of the things that happen for a lot of the Bigfooters.
They think you like humans. They are not think you like a local animal out there, because what would the deer like? What would an otter horse like? Or what would be good? Bigfoots don't care about that. They, like I said, they want humans. They want human things. Therefore, well, the Lord say banana, the Lord say oranges, things like that. They, no, they do like some snack on, so candy, they're probably not going to avoid. But if you put out meat, Bigfoots don't like muscle meat. Don't like stuff like lungs or livers or gallbladder, guts, pretty much. We think that is disgusting. But Bigfoots love it. And also, cooking the food. If you cook it, that's a guarantee they won't touch it. You put on a steak or something like that, they're going to avoid that like the plague. But a bunch of other animals won't.
So, well, yeah, most animals will go ahead and eat the cooked meat, but at the same time, you know, like in the case with dogs, it's really not that good for them, you know, but, I mean, they're scavengers and they'll eat that, but it tells me that the Bigfoot is an omnivore, very similar to us. You can eat fruit, nuts, I'm sure vegetables, but they're also capable of eating, you know, flesh, even though it's the innards and soft tissues, kind of like that, which makes sense. I mean, are they predatory at all? I mean, do they hunt down other animals or anything like that?
I believe so. I've heard of them hunting deer. But that makes a lot of sense, too. I've heard of them. One thing I've heard they will enjoy is eating frogs. So you take a box or a cage or whatever of frogs, I bet you Bigfoots will love that. You put them up there as a trap, a meat trap. Bigfoots are good for that big time.
So, I mean, it makes sense because, you know, a frog's pretty much all soft tissue. I mean, not a lot of muscle meat on a frog, you know.
Right.
For the most part, you know, when we eat a frog, we eat the legs and throw everything else away. So,
yep.
It's kind of interesting to see that, I mean, that they would eat those in particular. So, you know, if you're trying to attract a Bigfoot, you're trying to, you know, lure them in, like what you said, with a meat trap, then frogs would be one way to go. It seems to me that it makes sense considering the other things that you have laid out there that they eat, the soft tissues, the organ meats, basically.
And what does the skin of a frog taste like? Tastes kind of like guts, pretty much. Not that great, but at least for my pussy, not that great.
No, definitely not something that I'm looking forward to eating. It's not like, but again, I'm a human and I'm not a Bigfoot. So, I mean, and I haven't adapted to forest life like they have. Now, some other things that you brought up is that these things were bred for stealth. These creatures, these Bigfoot, and so when people report hearing loud crashes and things like that, then that is not something that is typically going to be Bigfoot behavior. I mean, why would a Bigfoot make a lot of noise?
To scare people. That's the main reason. If a real Bigfoot, it does make a lot of noise. It's to scare you, which typically works. But it's also something that a mythic hoaxer may not get right. They try to call attention to himself by making noise, but it also kind of says, well, I'm not sure if that's real. Now, that's one of those things that it could be real and it could not be real. Something else.
So, when looking at, you know, I would imagine a hoaxer is going to be very noisy traipsing through the woods where, because it's just simply not part of their environment. And if they're a hoaxer, they're probably dressed up in some kind of suit or something like that, or even potentially on stilts to attain that height. And I know I want to go back to the point of the stilts, which I think a lot of people, I think, don't understand about stilts. Everyone thinks about stilts in the manner that you laid out at the top of the show. You know, they're 20 feet tall, they're walking on stilts, you know, you got the Uncle Sam and the float, the parade or whatever. But they do make stilts that are a lot smaller than that. You know, all variants of sizes. So if you're 6 foot tall man and you want to be 8 foot tall, you can get 2 foot stilts, or you can set them to be 2 foot off the ground. So, you know, it's not like it's going to be all that clumsy, especially with somebody that's used to be walking on them.
So you go to Amazon and look at these right now. It's called drywall stilts. They're roughly 3 feet long. You get some of them very tight for a little bit. And they stick in your feet and you don't use your hands at all or anything like that. And they use them in painting all the time. They've been doing this for 1,500 years or something like that. There's nothing new.
So, I mean, when looking at that, I mean, that's going to make a lot of noise when somebody's running through the woods in that. And a lot of people say, well, they're not going to be able to move well, but the reality is, like you said, you know, it's something that people have been using for a lot of time. You're looking at anywhere from 18 to 30-inch stilts. And the way they're constructed is to basically just kind of extend the sole of your feet. So it's really not a clumsy apparatus.
No, not that clumsy. Really, with a bit of practice, I bet you get walking fairly quietly through the woods. It wouldn't be that difficult. A foot or whatever would actually be very wide, very long, it's a lot of stability. So that would not be that difficult to walk through the woods and those. The front wall is not hard. The part you need to pay attention to, the body has to be wide enough to match. I saw one in a video in Yosemite Park of Bigfoot's walking up to a bunch of buffalo. What I saw is they were tall and thin. They were not wide. They were not proportional to what really, if you know much about the golden ratio, it's about 1.6 or so, where your body is based on that measurement. Actually, all animals are based on that measurement, that ratio. So, custom match. To have a bunch of even NBA players, not just really tall. They're not. Remember my sister went up to Shaquille O'Neal and was like, man, he's really tall. But also, you can't even get your arms around the guy. She thought, why?
Right.
Yeah. They have to match.
So it's not very often then that you're going to have, 8 foot tall, 300 pound people.
Yeah. I mean, getting stilts with a bunch of sandbags or maybe, that weights is not difficult to do. It's not. And a little practice and all that comes right together.
And the thing is, people will sit there and go, well, it doesn't seem like that's reasonable that someone would go to such lengths, to practice, to construct a suit, to make all these points, happen.
But Halloween does not make sense.
But the fact is, people do this stuff, and they're more than willing to. And I don't understand the psychology of a hoaxer. Necessarily, as far as going to such great lengths, because for the most part...
They get a thrill out of it. That's it. They get a thrill out of it. They think it's fun. That's it.
Well, I guess, and they probably sit back and laugh at that everybody is buying into it as well. It is what it is. Now, coming back, though, the footprints that people find. I mean, how often are those, in your estimation, real footprints when they take the plaster casts and things like that?
Probably about 50% of the time. I think there are genuine Bigfoots out there, but I think that people have gotten nuts now about poaching all their stuff. And so... there's a whole bunch of hoaxes up there, too. But something like that can be fake, but might not be, I don't know. Some of them, it really depends. Probably good to have, or maybe we'll listen to that. Maybe let them suck.
So, I mean, when we're looking at those, how often, is a Bigfoot going to leave an obvious print, I guess, and...
That's what I've said. It's that, this is their life. This has been the press life. They are really, really good at doing this. But, at the same time, they're good thousands of pounds. Humans are basically like little kids, like a six-month-old child. They're only a few inches off the ground. They're these enormous creatures. They might leave few footprints. And we are really small and can see all that detail, just like a six-month-old child finding crumbs on the ground. Now, their eyesight is so good, is that they're so close to the ground. Humans are close to the ground. Humans find Bigfoot's crumbs.
So, then that is why we kind of are able to discover their footprints, is it simply because our proximity to the ground and to Bigfoot's aren't so close.
That's a big part of it. But like I said, Bigfoot might be 1,000 pounds, and he only leaves a few footprints, maybe. That he's still pretty good. If that's only leaves a few footprints, he's done really good. Some of them are really obvious that are probably going to be fakes. But the ones that are genuine, a little bit of crunch in the dust. That's it.
So we're just looking at, if it's obvious. I mean, this is one of those things, I guess, this axiom that it always comes back to. If it's too good to be true, it's probably too good to be true. I mean, it's probably not true.
don't think so.
So, I mean, you know, the fact that, you know, another thing that I see out there that, you know, I think is a huge supposition on a lot of people's parts and is that a lot of people are out at night looking for the Bigfoot as if they're, you know, a nocturnal creature. I mean, are they nocturnal, diurnal? I mean, what is your estimation on that?
I'm not entirely sure, but I think it may be because humans are glacial. Humans are awake during the day, so Bigfoots are awake at night. That could be it. Or it could be the foods that are more easily caught at night. They're not designed to see at night, but they are awake at night. Why would that be? They do that intentionally. They do something intentionally requires a higher intelligence than most animals.
So, you know, it's suggestive that, you know, it's very similar to us then, looking at it. It's suggestive that, you know, there are individuals within the population that may be more nighttime people than others, or vice versa.
It could be a cultural thing too. Warrior is most effective at night, do you think? Or is he most effective in the day with that bullet film? Could be a carryover thing. There are lots of reasons to make it the case. That is the case.
I mean, are most sightings occurring at nighttime, or are they kind of split? Because, you know, that's one of those things I don't quite grasp why it is that, you know, the Bigfoot researchers are always out at night. You know, because I also hear a lot of sightings that occur during the day, so I find it curious. I mean, of course, at the same time, if you look at how we live, we don't necessarily stop being active once the sun goes down.
Yeah, there's something that some of them are more active in the later at night, some of them more active in the morning, I've heard a lot of sightings meet in the early evening. That's when most of them are now. Humor in the early morning. Now, part of that is that's when there is light is in evening in the morning. I've heard a bunch of knocks and howls at night, late night. So, why they would do that is, like I said, it has to be intentional why they would do that. And intention denotes intelligence. And it has to be sentient level intelligence to do something intentionally. You have to have that. There aren't many animals that can claim that.
But, you know, and when you talk about intention, you know, making the noises and things, I have to wonder if that is like a performance to scare away the humans. They're aware the humans are there. They're aware that the humans are near them. And so they do the cries, hopefully that's going to scare away the humans, because what almost invariably happens is if it's a bunch of Bigfooters and they're hunting a Bigfoot, they start to go towards the sound. The sound goes away. The Bigfoot aren't found because they're intelligent enough to realize that the humans that they tried to scare away aren't being scared away, but are being attracted by the sounds.
That's one thing that I have been seeing, is that people do these Bigfoot calls over and over again. They don't know the language. They don't know the syntax. They don't know what it means. You scream orange, and famous later say, scream run. Famous later scream, you know, green. It doesn't take long to figure out that That's not a Bigfoot. That's not one of us.
Well, that's
but
like...
if you just scream out orange, and that's it. Like, what? What? Well, then we'll come and see what's happening. What's going on?
Well, exactly. It's like going into, you know, another country and screaming out the one word that you know. Eventually, people are going to figure out that you're not from that country because you only know one word.
Exactly.
We're talking with Matthew B. Thompson, and you can go on to grandarkconspiracy.com. You can link up to his works, How to Spot a Bigfoot Hoax and How Not to Find a Bigfoot. Those are all linked up at grandarkconspiracy.com. You can get a hold of those today. And we're going to go ahead and take a break here, and when we come back, we'll continue the conversation with Matthew on the other side.
Right in your arms, saying I love you, I do. Well, the dream that was walking and the dream that was talking, and the heaven in my arms was you.
This is Pete Emmons of Ag Today, inviting you to join us every Monday morning at 9 a.m. on QT 1270 and streaming online at qt1270.com.
I have a passion for the environment. That's why I serve in the United States Coast Guard. We monitor commercial vessels, making sure our ports and waterways are safe and clean from oil or other hazardous material. We patrol our fisheries, protect marine wildlife and their habitats. With all we do, it's about protecting America.
Were you born ready to protect America? Learn more at GoCoastGuard.com.
Sponsored by the United States Coast Guard in cooperation with the Ohio Association of Broadcasters and this station.
My name is Tom Thornton.
And my name is Cindy Thornton. We're retired, and this is how we live United.
We decided to volunteer with United Way at our community free health clinic.
United Way is how we contribute, because we know our time and money are going to the right places.
Judging by the thank yous we get at the clinic, I'd say we're doing the right thing with our retirement, too. We're Tom and Cindy Thornton. We volunteer at our community free health clinic. We don't just wear the shirt.
We live it.
Give. Advocate. Volunteer. Live United. Go to liveunited.org. Brought to you by United Way and the Ad Council.
Your paycheck. Your family depends on it. But if something happens to you, you need life insurance. And chances are SelectQuote can get it for you at a surprisingly low price. I'm Andy Dobbs, a SelectQuote term life insurance agent. I just found Alec, who's 38 and in great health, a 10-year, $500,000 policy for under $20 a month. Phil, 41, smokes an occasional cigar. I got him a 10-year, $500,000 policy for under $24 a month. Our secret? We impartially shop select, highly rated life insurance companies for your best rates.
For a free quote, call 1-800-946-2683. That's 1-800-946-2683. 1-800-946-2683. Or go to SelectQuote.com. Since 1985, we shop, you save. Get full details on the example policies at SelectQuote.com/commercials. Your premium could vary depending on your health, issuing company, and other factors. Not available in all states.
The Ohio Child Support Enforcement Agencies wish to thank employers for their contribution to Ohio's Child Support Program. Did you know that each year, employers collect nearly $1.4 billion in child support payments? We recognize that employers are key to the Child Support Program's success. Brought to you by the Ohio CSEA Directors Association. Visit us on the web at ocda.us for more information. The support of our partners is key.
Far from the city, where the Lorax roams free, is the home of the magical truffula trees. In a place you will love, with things you'll adore, it's a magical spot. We call it the forest.
Everyone here needs the trees.
And who are you?
I'm the Lorax, guardian of the forest.
The forest is there for you to explore. So come once to see it, then come back lots more.
I just like hearing you say it.
Visit discovertheforest.org, brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service and the Ad Council.
After thousands of years, after crippling millions of children, polio will soon be stopped forever. All over the world, people are joining the men and women of Rotary to end polio now. People like Jackie Chan and Jane Goodall.
We are this close.
This close.
People like Archbishop Desmond Tutu.
This close.
People like you. Be a part of history. Help Rotary end polio now at rotary.org/endpolio. We are this close.
From True Oldies 1270 WQTT, here is your Marysville area weatherbug forecast. For the rest of the morning, there's a slight chance of snow. Yesterday, mostly cloudy, low 24, weather winds to 15 miles an hour. Wednesday, snow is likely. Yesterday, mostly cloudy, weather high 35. Accumulations around an inch are possible. Look for snow Wednesday night, low 8. We could have an inch or two. Wind chills will be around 5 below with winds to 15 miles an hour. Thursday, we'll have a mostly sunny, cold day, our high 15 with wind chills to 10 below. For True Oldies 1270, I'm Rod Tanner.
We've got Matthew B. Thompson on the air with us, and we're talking about his works, How to Spot a Bigfoot Hoax, and How Not to Find Bigfoot. You can link up to those at grandarkconspiracy.com. Matthew, you know, when you look at trying to figure out whether you're in a hoax or not, there was something that in the book that you put out there I thought was a very interesting idea and a good way for people to kind of understand the situation a little bit better, to kind of raise red flags for them, that there's characteristics of a Bigfoot, and you know, it's if one of those characteristics are missing, it's not really a red flag. But when you begin to have two or more of those characteristics missing, it is. This is when you begin to have a problem with what you're experiencing as potentially being a hoax. And I don't know if you would like to kind of tell the listeners what these attributes are for a Bigfoot, and if they're missing, you know, what that tells us about the experience that the Bigfoot sighting is providing us.
Yeah, there's like the first thing you just ask yourself, whenever you see a potential Bigfoot, could this be a hoax? What did I actually see? What did I actually hear? What did I smell? Bigfoots are known for being really, 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 really stinky. I've heard it many times. They smell like a deer carcass that's been in a dumpster for a week. I think that's actually good if the deer carcass in particular. I'm wondering if it has to do with say, smearing deer blood or deer fat or whatever on the body. I wonder if you know how to make it invisible to infrared breath. Because that is, so there's some spheres in Costa Rica that are invisible to infrared breath. That's why I recommend a full spectrum camera. You can see all that stuff, because a full spectrum does UV as well as power as well as invisible. If you see it has the smell, but crashes in the woods, makes a lot of noise. Well, it's not doing the one thing, but it's doing something else. Well, that's probably not a hoax. You see that it's making a lot of noise and doesn't smell. That might be a hoax. It's completely silent in the woods. It's doing something all different. Probably not a hoax. Say a skunk can smell real, real bad, but it's only a defense mechanism. They don't normally smell that bad. They normally smell feces of the small cat. But that is the only animal in the world that has that bad of a scent all the time. Why would that be? That is not something that is genetic. That is not the, I guess it could be walking down the swamp all day. It could be he rolls around in the carcasses. Could be a bunch of different things. But, and like you really have to pay attention to, well, first of all, could this be a hoax? And then go from there. One good thing also, where am I right now? You know, not, your drone gets involved when you see something exciting and you forget. Okay, what did you actually see? What did you actually hear? Very good idea to write yourself down. You write all down, it won't change your mind. If you don't write it down, it will. It's not that you are manipulating things. Your brain does that for you. By having it written down, your brain can't do that.
So, I mean, I think it's a very interesting point. Is the first question that should be in your mind is, could this be a hoax? Mm-hmm. Because that sets you in a mindset that, you know, isn't going to be taking leaps of logic. It's going to kind of force you to be objective, to kind of understand exactly what it is you're seeing.
Exactly.
So then, you know, the next question that you describe is, what did I actually see? You know, and that's something, a point that, I mean, even a lot of people will miss, is that when you are adrenalized, everything's heightened.
Yeah.
And
if you focus on those particular questions, you reduce the adrenaline in your body. It'll force you to be logical and force a lot of that away, the adrenaline away. You will not be as excited. You'll be able to focus on all those things and make a much better logical decision.
So, you know, another thing that I thought was very interesting in the book is that if you begin to think it's a hoax, I mean, obviously, if you've sighted a Bigfoot, you know, and you just walked up on it, I'm going to guess that you don't have a camera ready, you don't have your cell phone camera app up, you're just going to have to accept the fact that you've witnessed something. But the funny thing is, if you do suspect it a hoax, this is something I think a lot of people would never think to do. And I think that is something that I find to be, would probably be the most effective way to figure out if you're in the middle of a hoax, is to shout out human words at them. Like, shoot them, kill them, fire, gun, fake, and hoax is what you have in here. But the reality is that if it's a hoaxer, if it's a human being in a suit, they're going to understand what it means to fire or gun, and it's going to definitely alter how they're trying to perpetrate the hoax. They might even stop and say, don't shoot.
Exactly. I mean, if they're a hoaxer, and they think they're going to shoot a gun at them, if they're going to run like the hell, yeah, they're going to kid, they're going to make a lot of mistakes. You pick up those easy. But conversely, if it's a real Bigfoot, he might just walk away to him. You might be setting friends or something like that. Yeah, it should be, you know, like, okay, whatever. I'll just go here.
Right. It's not going to mean the same thing. It's not going to have a fear reaction in the creature that it would exactly. in a human being. Because there's really no reason that it would understand exactly what's being said. So not that it wouldn't run away. I mean, obviously, if they have a history of avoiding us, it's going to want to run away. But there will be a difference in the reaction, I would imagine. I mean, I would think that a Bigfoot hoaxer is going to stop right where they are. They're not going to run away. They're going to say, stop doing what they are. They're going to take off their mask or whatever and talk back to you.
You can't do mine. You never know what the hoaxer would do. You really don't.
Well, and that's...
I mean, my running might, because the mask might scream and might do all kinds of things. You never know. But that will, at the very least, put the hoax back on him. If it's a real Bigfoot, it won't
matter. Well, it won't. And that's something, too, that I think a lot of people out there who would want to perpetrate a hoax really need to be cognizant of. This isn't a situation that you're putting yourself in that is safe by any stretch of the imagination. If you're going to go out in the woods, you know, where are you going to find most hunters? Where are you going to find most armed people in the United States? They're going to be out in the woods.
Yeah.
They're looking to shoot game. And you're dressed up in a Bigfoot costume, you're either going to scare them into shooting you, or they're going to think, hey, it's a Bigfoot. I'm, you know, this is my winning lottery ticket. So
yeah.
You're putting yourself at a huge risk by going out there and doing this.
Well, if it were me, I would wear a bulletproof vest. That's what I do. But then, what I told you before, just say, even if you have, say, a .22 rifle or something like that, you can always aim. I've heard a lot of people say, I saw this creature in the woods and all I had was a .22 rifle. Should I aim? Have I shoot him in the throat? Have I shoot him in the knee? Have I, whatever. Have I just shoot? You don't know how big the gun is.
Yeah. I think that most hunters would just shoot. They wouldn't cry out. They'd just shoot. And they're aiming for either the heart or the head. And that's just the reality of the situation. I would imagine with a creature like Bigfoot, most hunters would aim for the heart simply because they wouldn't want to damage the features of the head. But, you know, I can't speak to all hunters out there, but I mean, that just seems to be how most hunters are. They shoot for the heart, because that's an instant kill. It stops the adrenalization of the creature, but also allows, for, I guess, if you're a deer hunter, to take the trophy. Some other things that you've got in here that I find interesting. I mean, some huge mistakes, taking into account all the things that we've covered so far, is how Bigfooters go out there and look for Bigfoot. There's so many reasons why we don't get these creatures, you know, captured better on film or at all captured, period, is because of the way that we go out into the woods looking for them.
Yep. Like, people emulate what they see on TV. And the people on TV are trying to find Bigfoot. They're getting paid so they can look for Bigfoot. They're not finding Bigfoot. They're looking for Bigfoot. That's all they're doing. Now, you should, the techniques, they definitely do that work. Why would you do that? I mean, that's why I wrote How Not to Find Bigfoot. Your usual techniques, they definitely do not work. So, why are you still using them?
Well, as I say, I mean, there's so many things that I would think are common sense, and then there's others that, you know, aren't so much. I mean, you've got a list. I mean, one of the things that you have up here is by the time a Bigfooter realizes that he should be quiet, it's already too late. And you talk about how, you know, Bigfoot don't really have that exceptional hearing, but they're aware of their environment. They know that there's other creatures out in the woods who have human avoidance, and they see them and how they react. So they kind of understand when it's time to move, but they don't need exceptional hearing to hear someone walking through the woods because they don't walk. We don't walk through the woods typically stealthily.
Yeah, really, I mean, it's very easy to tell a four-legged animal from a two-legged animal just by sitting quietly in the woods. You can hear that. You're like, oh, wow. I mean, I am an Eagle Scout. I've been in the woods many times. You can tell this really pretty easily. You hear the click, 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 whatever. That's true, like the animal, that's something, looking at the click or looking at the door, so it's probably a person. Or you hear a four-legged host animal walking through the woods, or like, I can really tell you the hooves hitting the rocks and things, that's really easy to tell. So, get a horseback. That's how the passion gibbling thing was done. They were horseback. They were just going through the woods, but they were on horses.
Right.
And they had a catch back. Why would you avoid doing horses? Why would you avoid doing all the things? Why would you take a truck out there or go in a... or walk through the woods at night? That doesn't make sense. You have better luck than the other. Now, it may not be 100%, but it's much better luck.
So, I mean, using vehicles and things like that is probably a big no-no. Now, going in there, you know, I would imagine there's a lot of other things that we shouldn't do. I mean, even though Bigfoots don't necessarily have, you know, the keenest sense of smell either, I would think that it's pretty easy for them and other animals to pick up our scent. And once again, I mean, how would you suggest that we go in and look for our Bigfoot?
Again, this larger detective for taking with the scent and not having perfume. Really, it's just unscented larger detergent. That's it. He went in the bag, then placed the bag or the bag, the metal which, put it on the upper. Let's say, okay, we're now. Go take the shower, then... you know, get out, shower, smell the clothes you were just wearing, like 10, 15 minutes ago. They stink like all get out. That shit smells like all the time. Go get freshly laundered clothes, take them up there, change it to them. There you go. They're simple. That's what people don't like, simple answers, but the world is simple. It's a whole bunch of symbols all put together, which makes it very complex. But once you see the actual thing, it's very simple.
So, I mean, it's a simple step is to kind of help remove the human scent. And I'll, but eventually it's going to come back when you're in the woods. Is there a way for us to mask that? And how would you suggest we do that?
Well, you can have several sets of clothes, or you can use the... they have this stuff called raccoon urine. It's a scent that hunters use. That will mouth smell, but it's like a mouse your whole body. And besides, if your whole body stinks like all get out, you spray urine over your entire body, you can smell the toilet. So, bottle will change the clothes. Just simple solution and it's effective solution.
Well, it does seem to me the more simple that you, approach that you would take, the more effective it's going to be, because I don't think it just needs, you need to take back and be step back and be objective and look at the creature that you're hunting and look at the world through its eyes. You know, one of the tips that you have here is actually bringing in other animals. And, you know, coming back to the walking on 2 feet, thing. I mean, it would be harder for something with, you know, not great hearing to discern if there's, you know, you have, say you bring 2 dogs with you, and yourself, you know, that's 10 feet, you know, walking, and it's going to be a lot harder to discern if there's a bipedal creature along with it.
Oh, yes.
So,
you can just watch the deer, you can watch the coyotes, you can watch the birds. You have ears all over you, all around you. You don't need them. They're going to smell you. You don't need a good sense of smell. You don't need that.
So, when going out too, going out in large groups would probably hinder you as well. It should be kind of individually or in pairs then.
Probably not individual, just because the whole witness, whole accident thing playing up for seriously in the world. But I say pairs may be free. It just keep your footprint to the minimum. Don't want a group of people. You could have a group of people searching in twos. Sure. That's probably a good idea. But to have like 5 or 6 people in one group, that's probably not the best idea in the world. It's not worth stealthy.
Well, it's not. I mean, the more people you get together, the less stealthy it is. And the more likely people are going to want to engage in conversation when you're out wandering through the woods. I think, you know, the more people you have around you, the more likely you're going to want to communicate with them.
Right.
And another thing that I think a lot of people would take for granted is taking out things that are kind of modern contraptions or shiny or things like that that are unnatural to the environment. You know, that I think would be a huge red flag.
Yeah. Oh, part of it is a big red flag, yes. Part of it is that Bigfoot are curious creatures. They're kind of torn because humans are intelligent enough to be interesting. But they're also to be avoided. So they're kind of the back and forth between which was which. Chances are the younger Bigfoots would be more likely to be near humans. And older Bigfoots are closer enough to stay completely away from humans. That's just the way human races are. That's the way human culture is. That makes sense.
So, you know, one of the things that I find interesting, and we touched on earlier, is the kind of Bigfoot calls. It's not that you can't use those in finding them, it's just how you use them.
Yeah. What I say is make one Bigfoot call. And really, Bigfoots are fast critters. They'll come to you fast. They're long loops. It can run at like 30, 40 miles an hour. They're quick. They don't have, if they're stuck in the woods, they're about a pound, sick enough to relate the wind to grass. They will come quick. Be ready with the camera.
Yeah, so I mean, it's something that you can do to bring them to you, but once you begin doing more than one call, you're going to lose them, basically.
Exactly. They might answer you at first, then you do it a few more times, like, okay, you know what about us? Okay, let's shut up, let's move on. And that's exactly what you see. Things started out great in the beginning, and then it just got real quiet afterwards. That's exactly what happens. You don't understand the language involved. Like I was going to mention also, Bigfoot knocks. When you hear a Bigfoot knock, you know what a Bigfoot knock is. But then basically just bang on the tree. They take the stick and they bang on the tree. Look at your hand. Your hand is maybe 7 inches long. Bigfoot hand is about 12, 15 inches long. How big of a stick would he pick up? What kind of sound would he make? Pick up a dead branch. Maybe not a live branch, so maybe green wood. If he hit this tree. You can tell the difference between a solid piece of dead wood and a rotting branch or a green branch. It's a very easy sound to distinguish. So if you hit a tree with dead wood, with dead hard wood, it's a kind of a high-pitched sound. When you hit a tree with a rotting or a green wood, it's a little pitch sound. The water in the wood will absorb a lot of sound. Same thing's true with the rotting branch. It's got holes in it from where the fungus is, rotted lots of fungus. But also, he knows that that's a stick because it didn't sound right. Maybe that's why I thought was so stupid with the whole funny Bigfoot thing. Did all these baseball bats thing for not in the woods. Like, that's not exactly a branch you'd find with them. It's a very different sound. And that crack versus a branch hit that tree are very different sounds. You could tell those rough by suspect. No pun intended.
We're talking with Matthew B. Thompson, and we have to take our last break here.
Of course, you can go on to grandarkconspiracy.com and link up with the books we've been discussing tonight, How to Spot a Bigfoot Hoax and How Not to Find Bigfoot, which I think is the method that most people are using, the How Not to Find Bigfoot, evidently. So you'll be able to link up to those at grandarkconspiracy.com. We're going to go ahead and take this last break, and when we return, we'll have Matthew on the line with us for just a little while longer.
This is Pete Emmons of Ag Today, inviting you to join us every Monday morning at 9 a.m. on QT 1270 and streaming online at qt1270.com.
Policies issued by American General Life Insurance Company, Houston, Texas. Not available in all states. For details, visit AIGdirect.com.
So I knew it was important to have life insurance to protect our family, but I was putting it off. But then yesterday, a girlfriend of mine asked me, point blank, what would happen if you lost your husband? How would you pay the bills? The mortgage? The car payments? Food? And that's when it really hit me, and I realized I needed to get us life insurance. Right now. So I called AIG Direct, and in less than 5 minutes, I had a quote. I was shocked at how affordable it is. Now just $14 a month for $250,000 of term life coverage. I feel so much better knowing the kids and I are protected. And my husband was so happy I got the quote.
Save up to 70% when you get term life insurance through AIG Direct. Call now for a free, no obligation quote. It only takes 5 minutes, and you could save up to 70%. Call now, 1-800-566-2821. That's 1-800-566-2821. 1-800-566-2821.
We live in a pretty nice neighborhood, really safe. Yeah, a few families have security systems, but not us. We felt really safe. Till last week, when someone broke into our home. We were gone less than an hour, and they took just about everything that wasn't nailed down. Jewelry, TVs, artwork, even the kids' video games. We thought this couldn't ever happen to us. We thought wrong. My wife and I felt violated, and our kids were scared to go back in the house. So we asked one of the neighbors about their security system, from Alliance. And then we called them.
If you think this can't happen to you, think again. Then call Alliance Security and get peace of mind for less. A lot less. We offer free same-day installation for many neighborhoods. Plus give you a $100 Visa gift card. Call us right now at 1-800-593-9601. That's 1-800-593-9601. Free same-day installation and a $100 Visa gift card. 1-800-593-9601.
This is a referral service. Calls will be routed to an independent referral insurance agency.
Do you know the number one cause of bankruptcy? No, it's not losing your job or running up credit card debt. It's not even divorce. It's medical costs. If you and your family don't have health insurance, just one serious illness or accident could be financially devastating. But now there's good news, really good news. A health insurance hotline has been established to provide health insurance for all Americans, even uninsured Americans with pre-existing conditions. Now anyone can get health insurance even if you have a pre-existing medical condition. I repeat, now anyone can get health insurance coverage. Call now for a free no-obligation quote on affordable health plans available to you. Again, this is a free hotline for anyone, even if you have pre-existing conditions. Protect you and your family from sudden unexpected medical costs. Call the free health insurance hotline right now at 1-800-842-1835. That's 1-800-842-1835. Call 1-800-842-1835.
Maybe it's time to take a fresh look at everything we thought we knew about landing a great job. For instance, perhaps great careers start at the middle school science fair instead of at the job fair. Because the fact is, the jobs of the future will be heavily geared towards science, technology, engineering, and math. In other words, STEM. So if you're a student, talk to your school counselor about STEM. If you're a parent, talk to your kids. A public service message from America's Navy.
From True Oldies 1270 WQTT, here is your Marysville area weatherbug forecast. For the rest of the morning, there's a slight chance of snow. Here today, mostly cloudy, low 24, weather winds to 15 miles an hour. Wednesday, snow is likely. Here today, mostly cloudy, weather high 35. Accumulations around an inch are possible. Look for snow Wednesday night, low 8. We could have an inch or two. Wind chills will be around 5 below with winds to 15 miles an hour. Thursday, we'll have a mostly sunny, cold day, our high 15 with wind chills to 10 below. For True Oldies 1270, I'm Rod Tanner.
Matthew B. Thompson on the line with us, and we've been talking about how to spot a Bigfoot hoax and how not to find Bigfoot, which I think
I think most people understand how not to find a Bigfoot, Matthew. What do you think?
Hoax are they keep doing the same things they see not working, but I don't know. That's what they see. So,
for me, and this is something I've expressed before. If I could find a Bigfoot, I would. I'm not sure I would share it with the rest of the world. You know, it's one of those things. I think I would. I would just move on and not tell people where to find it. You know, to me, I think. I think understanding that there's a Bigfoot out there for the world around would be really horrible for Bigfoots.
Exactly. I think Bigfoot has been found many times, but people don't say anything. The Bigfoots are very, very similar to humans. Like in the world of primates, the world wolf. Chimpanzees are genetically the closest of the rest of the human. They're less than 1% difference between human and chimpanzee genetics. But it cannot breed. Therefore, there's actually Indian stories of Bigfoots breeding with humans. These children have problems. But they actually conceived. That means they're even closer than chimpanzees. You could argue that it's, you know, an aberration, that, you know, that, well, it's a throwback from prehistory or something like that, the missing link or whatever it is. The fact is, it's so close to a human that it can breathe with them.
So, I mean, the suggestion that Bigfoots could breed with humans, that leads us down a logical path that they're really very, very close to us. Now, you said there's a problem with the children. I also had to wonder if it's like, you know, the kind of mutant offspring that can't have offspring of its own, then?
Well, that what I've heard is that the children go to death, which doesn't make any sense, but what does make sense is that different organs grew at a different rate. That kind of makes sense, but what's more likely is strength. They're so physically strong that they got killed or were so aggressive that they picked a bunch of fights and ended up getting killed. Who knows what the actual reason? But, like I said, the important part is they were offspring. Not that they died. They died because they were human culture. That's why. But even to this day, a lot of North Macedonians will protect their women or any woman when a Bigfoot is reported to be nearby. Because of that exact same thing. Like, for example, no, the human male is not attracted to a goat that's in heat or something like that.
Right.
It just, the chemicals just do not job whatsoever. Or even a chimpanzee in heat. Human male wouldn't think twice about that. Like, then why would that be attracted? Well, why would a Bigfoot be attracted to a human woman who's not that genetically close? There doesn't have to even be real evidence of them breeding. Just the attraction alone is evidence that it's possible, because the smell, because such attraction at all is evidence that it's possible. Like I said, chimpanzees use of humans are too far apart. They are not attracted to each other at all. But Bigfoot and humans are. You know, humans are not attracted to Bigfoots, but Bigfoots are attracted to humans. Actually, I'm not sure that humans are attracted to Bigfoots. I'm putting away some of the stories online. So.
Well, and that's just it. I mean, well, when you're talking about these creatures, then the evidence suggests, just the mere attraction suggests then that they are more human than they are anything else.
Right. Yep. And like I said, different cultures, like I said, the whole Atlantis thing coming to North America or South America, and you're going to split off into different groups. Each group will do things a little bit different from every other group, so the Bigfoot will be just a little bit different from each other.
Well, and that's suggestive of adaptation as well. I mean, that's something you should actually expect to see, is differences regionally from population to population. Matthew, we're at the end here, and I want to thank you for coming on and talking about Bigfoot with us. And to all the listeners, of course, go out to granddarkconspiracy.com. You can link up to the books, How to Spot a Bigfoot Hoax and How Not to Find Bigfoot, for a lot more information on what we've just discussed here. Thanks again, Matthew. It's been an absolute pleasure speaking with you.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
And to all the listeners out there, until tomorrow night, keep conspiring.